The Lotus Emira. One of the last and greatest lightweight, mid-engined sports cars. A tribute to the manual gearbox and the love of driving. Just 1 year ago, this car was a new dawn for Lotus. Now it's the end of the line for Lotus as we know it.
What do you mean, the end of the line for Lotus?
After this, they're all going electric.
All of them?
Yep, all of them.
What the f-? The Lotus Emira. I love and I hate this car. And the few that I've driven have been a little strange. This one is the first I've driven with the touring chassis. It's actually something I've been excited to do for a bit. We all know the highlights. This is Lotus's lightweight, mid-engined answer to the Porsche Cayman. Enough dilly-dallying, let's get the f*** out of here. It's the same old Emira as before. They haven't changed anything in a year. The touring chassis gets a Goodyear supercar tire. A lot more forgiving, a lot easier to drive, and sort of takes away the spikiness that the sport chassis had. I can actually kind of drive this around every day and it's not breaking my back. It's not annoyingly loud. And you don't lose anything in these canyons up here in this lovely little road. If anything, it's more fun. It feels more hooked up because you can actually sense what the car is doing. The classic Emira stuff is still here though. Everyone loves to rave about this hydraulic steering, everybody. And it is better. On center, it's better. Off-center, you still have this really weird buildup of weight. You can see it. If I just palm it through these bumps, you'll see the wheel fighting and speaking, and it's really lovely in that way. But I still kind of demand more weight buildup. I'm not sure what's going on there. But the Lotus stuff, which steering is supposed to be the Lotus stuff, the rest of the Lotus stuff is very good. But especially, there's this gearbox, which is unapologetically its own thing. It's not trying to be soft or nice for you. You have to shift the shit out of it. You really have to properly give it some arm into it. If you mess up, it'll grind. It won't forgive you. Okay, so let's dig deeper into the sport versus touring suspension differences. Lotus doesn't really talk too much in detail about what they did. They really just say, oh yeah, touring's a bit softer, sport's a bit harder. A lot of the difference, I'll grant you, is in the tires, but I do feel a difference in the bias of damping. The thing with these Goodyears is it's a completely different philosophy to the Michelin Cup 2, where the Cup 2 has like a really soft sidewall. The construction is different in the Michelins. They're designed to flex around and find traction in their own way. This Goodyear is a much more traditional kind of tire. It's much more rigid. I feel like there's a bit less rebound in the rear compared to the front. It makes the car a bit more pushy, a bit more, I guess you could say, understeer. I hate that term. But the car is really quite suggestible to the throttle, and it kind of leads back to another weird thing about this car, which is the weight distribution. Let's think Cayman. Those cars are 45% front weight, 55% rear. I'll give you a second to guess what this is. No, you're wrong. It's 39% front, 61% rear. It is the same weight distribution as a modern 911. Only Lotus could do that. Here's the critical difference though, is the engine is on the rear axle. It's not over it. So it behaves differently to a 911. It doesn't have all the traction in the world like a 911 does, but it also doesn't turn on the brakes like a 911 does either. It's because it has a different polar moment of inertia. Everything is closer to the center of the car, which makes it a bit more of a handful closer to the limit, let's say. Then there's the 3.5 liter supercharged V6 back there. We all know the story. It's a Toyota motor, har har har, but it's really quite exciting. What I do like is that the power band is really peaky, even if it doesn't rev high. At 5,500 RPM, just before red line, this thing wakes up. It wakes up. It's so exciting. And the engine mounts are fairly hard, so you're feeling all this vibration from the drivetrain. You're hearing all this accessory noise. It's so much more exciting and engaging than a Cayman is. This suspension is so beautifully damped. There's a thing that Lotus used to say, which was the car needs to breathe with the road. The Sport did not breathe with the road. It argued with the road. It didn't like the road. This car has such a nice conversation with the surface. It's never punishing, but it's also not floaty. This touring suspension is just so much lovelier. It actually damps out bumps. The little stuff is still there, it's just sort of filed down, but the big stuff is just so beautifully absorbed by this car. It's so much better than the sport car. I just can't believe that it's even a choice. Like, I think this is just the one to get. The sport is just too stiff, it's too annoying, the tire spec is just wrong for daily use, and the Cup 2s are not great on the track either. You'd be better off buying a better 200 treadwear tire. So where the Boxster Spider and the Cayman, by extension, are some of the most well-developed sports cars on Earth, perfect in almost every way, this can only be really considered objectively really good. Where it really shines is that annoying thing that I can't give to you through the screen. It has this feel thing, it has a thing going on. It feels special to be in. And a Cayman is, you get in a Cayman, it's all nice. You know, everything's engineered properly. It's like quiet, it's good. But I've never really driven a Cayman that makes my hair stand on end, you know, even a GT4, maybe a GT4 RS would, but then we're talking, what, 200 grand? This for 105, this is the most you can do for the money. This is the most sports car you can do. It's not the most luxury, it's not the most GT, it's the most sports car you can do for the money. This is the Uber BRZ, the Uber GR86. This is not a Porsche. This is a sports car for sports car people, is what this is. You have to accept some things about it. You kind of have to like it for what it is. Like, you can't put a Cayman person in this. They'll be like, well, what is this piece of shit, dude? Why is it doing all these things? And that's okay. You know, we need to have cars that are wrong sometimes. It has a personality. It makes you want to drive it. It's such a vibe to just get out. It's romantic is what it is. You look at the mirror, you see that side vent and the yellow paint. You see the world kind of falling behind you from this car. It's just such an escape.
All right. Don't let the nice interior, the screens, and this incredible shape fool you. Underneath this car is actually something ancient. It's a Lotus Evora. So back here, what screamed out at me was the rear upper control arm and the lower one actually are both on a flat plane relative to the car. What does that mean? That means there's no geometric anti-squat in the car, which means the car has no suspension like resistance to squatting down under acceleration. Same story here, even more obviously, because you could see just how flat the control arm is. It explains a lot of behavior in the car because most cars, even down to a Toyota 4Runner, has geometric anti-squat in it, just to help control that pitching and diving motion as you're accelerating and braking. And the same thing is there's not a lot of caster in the car. The steering axis isn't super laid back. What happens when you don't do that, when you don't add caster, is you get very light steering. And that's kind of what happens here. You have this globally heavy hydraulic steering that doesn't build up in weight. It doesn't stop with the suspension either. The car is constructed differently to pretty much every other car ever made. Instead of it being, I guess what you consider a monocoque chassis, it's a bonded aluminum. So basically they take a bunch of pieces of aluminum and glue them together. Sounds like it's dangerous. It isn't really. It's a Lotus innovation actually, and it started back with the Elise. They then modified the tub, made a new tub for the Evora. This is the Evora's tub. This is an Evora. It just has a very pretty body on it and a nicer interior. So this is it. This is the last gas-powered Lotus sports car. After this, the company is very keen to go electric. There's already the Elettre, there's the Emeya, and there's gonna be an electric replacement for this. There's no doubt about it, this car dies in 2027 after such a long history, making lightweight, amazing, focused sports cars. This belongs right there. And the fact that it won't live to see the next decade, it's a crime.